Cano agas diner. Find out what that means and where I am in just a moment. Today's tale is of a dream house in a land far away.
It's like a real oasis in the middle of all these trees. It's like you're in the middle of a forest. It's sort of Hansel and Gretel-ish almost, isn't it?
So if you're sitting comfortably, let our house search begin.
So get your little Red Riding Hood capes on, because we're off to see the three bears.
Oh, brilliant.
Oh, wow.
Okay.
Fantastic.
Come on, Goldilocks.
Right this way, Goldilocks.
I'm on the banks of the beautiful River Tamar, the natural border between Cornwall and Devon. And Cano agas diner means welcome to Cornwall, which is where I am today. Now, the Cornish language is derived from the ancient Celtic dialogue that was spoken by settlers to the British Isles long before the Romans invaded. It was first recognised as a distinct language in 600 AD, but had mostly died out in spoken form by the 19th century. But in recent times, it's enjoyed a welcome resurgence, and in 2009, Cornwall Council recognised it as a unique cultural asset to be safeguarded and promoted with pride. The county of Cornwall forms a peninsula to the southwest of England, with coastlines to the north and south. The county's name is derived from its shape, with corn meaning cairn or horn. Recognised as one of the Celtic nations, the Cross of St Piran's, white on a black background, is the flag of the region and dates back to at least the first part of the 19th century. Bodmin Moor is a designated area of outstanding natural beauty, with towering granite tors, bogs and marshes. The landscape can inspire awe as well as trepidation and is the source for many myths and folk tales. At the Bodmin and Wentford Railway, it's possible to see and ride steam-hauled trains. Operating along a 13-mile track, the ride here combines the charm of a bygone era of travel with picturesque scenery. But as well as the sublime moorland, there's the stunning coastline. The north coast is particularly popular with surfers. At New Quay, Fistral Beach is one of the best surfing beaches in Europe and hosts a large board sports festival every year. 20 or so miles north, Polzeth is another wave rider's haven. The beach can disappear at high tide, leaving behind the pretty headland and village, once a favourite haunt of the late poet laureate Sir John Betjeman, who celebrated it in some of his verse. So if you'd like to ride the wave of the unique county of Cornwall, why not plan a country escape soon? With hundreds of miles of beautiful coastline, it's got to be the sea that's the big draw in Cornwall. But when it comes to properties by the water, expect to pay a premium of up to 50% for those breathtaking sea views. But having said that, the average cost of a detached property across the region comes in at £22,000 below the national figure, with the best bargains to be had inland and away from the desirable north coast. So why did today's couple fancy a slice of Cornish life? Let's meet them and find out. Today's buyers are Tony, a dentist, and Debbie, a dental nurse and practice manager. This husband and wife team have recently sold up their dental practice and home in the Warwickshire town of Leamington Spa and are looking towards retirement.
Currently, we are living over the shop, as it were. We live in a beautiful Grade 2 listed building with the dental practice on the ground floor, which has worked really well for us over the last 10, 12 years. But there are downsides to it. It's a busy town. There's lots of industries moving sort of around Leamington now. But we are now looking forward to our retirement in a couple of years' time and generally a quieter, more peaceful life.
And to find that less hectic lifestyle, they've set their sights southwest towards the sea.
We decided to move to Cornwall because we love the countryside, rolling hills, we've got the coast, everything's sort of small and quaint. Once you get over the border into Cornwall, there is a feeling of, oh, we're here.
The countryside, the topography of it changes almost as soon as you cross the border. Lots of interesting scenery. It just seems to fulfil all the needs, wants and desires one could have for retirement.
Although currently renting and working as employees in the dental business they once owned, They're looking forward to the next chapter and a chance to enjoy a completely different way of life.
We enjoy cycling. You can't cycle in Leamington and it's very busy, there's lots of traffic. It's not something you really like doing. I have a great love of horses. I really love horse riding. So it's definitely something I'd like to do more of when we move. There's nothing nicer than having a good gallop down the beach.
My main interest in terms of hobbies is golf. I'd like to be able to play two or three times a week. There's some beautiful golf courses down in Cornwall. So yeah, really looking forward to that. And maybe getting Debbie interested in playing as well.
As well as pursuing existing hobbies in the Cornish countryside, they're hoping for a country home that will give them the chance to get green-fingered.
We're definitely looking forward to having some more land. Mm. Because we live in the middle of the town, we have a small outside space. Yeah. It's more like a yard, but what we really want is land.
I've never really been into gardening, but I'm quite looking forward to learning the ropes, as it were. I'd actually like to think I can grow my own veg and fruit as well.
But most of all, it's about the peace and quiet of rural living.
For me, moving to the countryside means we don't have car horns, we don't have partygoers at 1 a.m. coming out of the pub. Fresh air, freedom, space, quiet.
Freedom, basically.
Tony and Debbie would like to concentrate their search in the north of the county. But before we start looking at houses, I'm meeting them in their chosen location to find out what they want from the move.
Good morning, you two.
Morning.
Hi there.
Welcome to Cornwall.
Thank you.
Now, Cornwall is a huge and very beautiful county. What is it about this particular part that makes you want to move here so much?
You've got access to the very south and Land's End. You can go to the north coast.
Everywhere is pretty much accessible from this part of Cornwall, really.
Now, I understand that you're sold and you're ready to go, is that right?
Absolutely. Yeah. We're cash buyers, so that makes it nice and easy. We are still committed to working in Leamington for the next 2 years, but we just want to put our money into the property now.
So let's talk about the house that you're hoping to find here.
Yeah.
What do you have in mind when you think about this lovely home that you're going to share together here?
Very much a character property, a country property, somewhere with some land, space to breathe.
And yeah, we don't want a nice, neat lawn. We want land like an orchard or a spinney or woodland, just to have that feeling of space around us. The kitchen's probably one of the most important parts of it. You know, big farmhouse kitchen, so if you're coming off your land or you're coming in, you can throw your wellies in the corner and not worry about walking into your kitchen. Nice single nook fireplaces.
And yeah. In terms of location, a nice village pub to walk to on a summer's evening. That would be great.
We do want edge of village so that we're not completely isolated. To have a stables nearby, I don't mind having to drive to it, that would be ideal.
Okay. Well, remind me of the budget that we're working with for the search.
We did up it slightly, didn't we, to get the house of our dreams. So our budget is £525,000.
Well, you'll be pleased to hear that we've got some very nice properties to show you.
Excellent.
Fantastic. Are you ready?
Yes, definitely.
More than ready.
Let's go and look.
Yeah.
Thanks.
So, with a budget of up to £525,000, Debbie and Tony would like a character property with some land. They'd like features including an inglenook fireplace and beams, and a large country kitchen at the heart of the home. Ideally, they're after an edge of village location. We've got three wonderful and very different homes to show them, and at each I'll be getting them to guess the price before I reveal it. The last property will be a mystery house, which could offer our couple a fairy tale future. Our search is starting in the outskirts of Lostwithiel. This small market town at the head of the Foy estuary dates back to the 12th century and was once a stannery centre where proceeds from the tin mining industry were collected on behalf of the Crown. Now known as the antiques capital of the county, its vibrant community hosts many regional events, from vintage fairs to a cider week. The town bridge features 5 pointed arches with parts thought to be 13th century. Whilst in the countryside outskirts, Restormel is one of Cornwall's 4 Norman castles and has a notably circular design. And in its own delightfully rural edge of town setting, we find house number 1.
Really pretty. That's a great start.
It is, isn't it? Looks great.
First impressions are really nice.
Yeah.
Love the look of the land. Really, really rustic. Really nice, yeah. Plenty of space
loads
to park
of trees.
Your cars.
Looks fantastic.
Are you keen to explore
looking
inside?
Looking forward to seeing inside, yeah.
Certainly am.
Well, there's a lot to show you, so let's go and explore.
Yeah. Brilliant.
This brick and cob cottage with slate roof is believed to have been a tannery and dates back 3 centuries. And inside, the period charm has been retained.
So we're through that pretty little entrance hall into a very, very cosy living room.
Yeah, it is. Beautiful fireplace. Yeah.
Stonework. That's fantastic.
And the walls are really thick. It's really quiet.
I think in here you really get the character and the feel.
It's lovely. Yeah. Really nice. Yeah.
Could you imagine yourself in here, Tony, on a cold winter's evening?
Yes, absolutely, with the log burner going.
Now, I know that for you in particular, that it's the kitchen. It's all about the kitchen, the heart of the home.
Yeah.
So I think you're going to like this one. So let me squeeze through and then just follow on. I'm going to take you through.
To the other side of the entrance hall, we pass through a dedicated dining room, again packing in those period features and taking us through into a century-old extension running the length of the property, home to a classic country kitchen.
Oh, I think it's quite a nice kitchen, personally.
Oh, very nice, yeah. Yeah, really nice.
You're smiling.
Yeah,
you're really smiling.
I love the range.
Yeah, it's an oil-fired range, which, of course, is really practical, but also that's operating the central heating as well.
It's really nice, really nice.
So just off the doorway there, you've got a little utility and a downstairs toilet.
Okay. Feels quite nice and simple. It's not busy.
Very warm, homely feel to it, I'd say.
Yeah. So is this a good start?
It's a good start.
So it is.
Yeah.
So we've got 4 bedrooms upstairs to go and have a look at.
Okay.
So follow me. Let's go and take a look.
Well, a warm response to this 300-year-old cottage on the ground floor. And upstairs are 4 bedrooms, which should be more than enough to suit Tony and Debbie. Above the kitchen is the family bathroom, flanked to either side by 2 smaller guest bedrooms. A double with countryside views, as well as a skylight window. And the smallest bedroom, again with side and roof aspects. Then, to the front of the house is the largest of the guest doubles. And we're making our way to bedroom number 4.
So here's the master bedroom.
Nice.
Yes. Love the beams again.
Really nice. Very nicely done.
Yeah, again, you can see the older character in here. You've got the maker's marks up in the beams.
Everything about the house so far is really quite nice and country but simple.
Yeah.
They've done it really nicely.
It's got lots and lots of good points, this place.
Everything is a little bit smaller than we expected, but by the time you're seeing the whole property and you put it all together, it doesn't need to be any bigger than this, and it is a good contender. What we've seen so far is really nice.
Yeah.
OK, well, I think the garden and the outside space is what could possibly swing this from being a good contender to the contender.
Yeah,
right. OK. So, come on, let's go and explore it, because there's a lot to explore.
Well, they said they wanted land, and this country cottage comes with plenty. In fact, there are 4 acres of gardens and woodland, as well as a summer house and patio seating off the kitchen. Certainly a far cry from their tiny town centre yard.
It's just so pretty and peaceful in this garden, isn't it?
It's beautiful. Absolutely lovely.
It's really lovely. It's exactly what we asked for. We didn't want a nice, neat lawn. This is perfect. Yeah, really
it's
nice.
It's like a real oasis in the middle of all these trees. It's like you're in the middle of a forest. It's sort of Hansel and Gretel-ish almost, isn't it?
Fantastic riding locally. Good stables that you can go to ride. The nearest is 10 minutes away.
Yeah.
That's really handy.
Yeah,
10 minutes
really
to the golf club.
Sounds good.
So that's your Monday sorted out, golf and riding.
Yeah, no, perfect.
What do you think this property is on the market for?
My best guess is 460,000.
OK, Debbie, over to you.
I'm going to go a bit higher. I think I'm going to go 490.
I'm afraid you're both wrong.
Okay. No surprise
so
there.
We're going to meet in the middle of both of you. Oh. It's on the market for £475,000.
Oh,
it's been on the market for about a month.
I'm pleasantly surprised because I thought the land and the location would bring it a little bit higher than that.
More and more, I like it, particularly now we've seen the land.
The more you walk around, the more you then come out, the more I see, the more I like it.
OK, well, why don't you go and have another look around? You said you wanted to be able to come in off your land, through the back door...
Throw the wellies in the kitchen.
We can't throw your wellies in the kitchen, but off you go, off the land and through the back door.
Thank you very much. Okay.
Leaving £50,000 to play with in the budget, this 300-year-old brick and cob cottage comes with 2 charming reception rooms, a kitchen with a range and 4 bedrooms. With its own rambling 4-acre plot, it's well located on the outskirts of a small market town.
OK,
at this ground, look at this land, 4 acres. I can't believe the size of it. I mean, you know, all this would belong to this one house. It's incredible.
I'm really pleasantly surprised. The more I walked around, the more I liked it. It's very pretty. The location is perfect. It's perhaps a little compact. The kitchen's fantastic. It goes out into the garden, which I really like.
The land with it is just amazing. I mean, that is a big, big bonus. The house itself is lovely, very old, full of character, full of exposed beams. The fact that there's only one bathroom is a slight drawback. We were ideally looking for an ensuite with the master bedroom.
I could see myself living here with a few changes, but I'm looking forward to seeing the next property just in case.
The fact that it's under budget obviously means that it's quite an attractive proposition, but price isn't the be-all and end-all. It's really, you know, where we want to be for our retirement.
This is a lovely spot, listening to that brook. It's beautiful.
It is, isn't it? It's gorgeous.
Have you seen enough?
Yes. The more I see, the more I like.
That's good. That's perfect. But hold those thoughts, because we've got two more great houses to see.
OK.
Great.
Britain's history of domesticating horses goes back over 4,000 years. By the time the Romans invaded in 55 BC, they were met by proficient horsemen ready to do battle. But modern riding styles were really developed in the 18th century, when the growing popularity of fox hunting, combined with the enclosure of land, required horse and rider to jump fences and hedges. Over 1 million Brits now ride, and Cornwall, with its variety of trails through wood, moor and coast, is one of the best places to enjoy the pastime. Debbie and Tony plan to make the most of the horse riding opportunities in the region, so we're sending them to find out about an equestrian craft from Cornwall's first master saddler, Jane Talbot Smith.
Can you tell me a little bit about what you actually do here?
Anything to do with horses. So I do side saddle girths and reins. And then because it's a country area, branched out, and I do human belts, I do horse people have dogs, so we do dog collars and dog leads. And then shooting people come in and can you mend my cartridge bags? You name it, it comes in, I take a pattern and make it again.
How did you actually get into saddlery and working with leather?
I actually went and worked for horse-drawn vehicles and built horse-drawn vehicles for 2.5 years. Started doing the leather on them, then went to saddlery college, which was a 1-year course at that time in London. It has a certain skill. A strap is a strap, whether it goes around a human, on a horse, on a dog, a strap's a strap. And techniques just vary slightly. We buy the leather and then you cut it into strips, edge it, stain it, crease it, punch a hole for the buckle, put the buckle in, stitch it up.
Well, I can't wait to see your workshop.
Good.
So.
Well, let's go in.
Fantastic.
Thanks.
In her compact workshop, Jane crafts hundreds of items a year, from specialist harnesses involving over 100 hours of work to smaller items.
This is a saddle bag on the back of the saddle, on
nice.
There, to take your sandwiches binoculars, or whatever you want.
And these are really useful, I think, with riding as well, because you're not really supposed
Absolutely.
To put phones and things in your pocket.
Well, I also do a front one, which
nice.
Was designed for phones.
Yeah, yeah.
But it's not all about saddlebags for smartphones. Some of Jane's pieces hark back to a bygone era.
Bellows like this, which I do the carving on, woodwork.
Wow. Goodness.
That is beautiful, so intricate. Yes.
Unfortunately, the market for bellows has dropped a bit because everybody has wood burners and they don't need bellows.
Demand for bellows may be waning, but Jane's beautiful hand-stitched strapwork sells as far afield as the United States, Germany and Zimbabwe.
If you want to check whether it's hand-stitched or not, always look at the back, because the back is never as smooth
uneven.
As the front. You get some who are really good stitchers, better than me, and every so often they'll throw a stitch out like that to prove that it's hand-stitched.
Oh, right.
Really?
Because a machine can't
throw a stitch.
So, what can we do today?
Well, I thought you might like to try a bit of plaiting.
Oh, OK.
Right.
Let's have a go.
Jane is plaiting in the round, using 4 strips of leather that are kept under tension to create a really tight finish.
And the theory of plaiting is always you work from the outside over one to the inside.
I see.
Hold that knot there, and then with that hand, pick that one up, pick this one up, and put it over the middle one. And take that one. Yes, you want to keep the top of the leather always on the top.
On that, right.
Now you're getting there.
It
really is. It's not as easy as it looks.
I would imagine if you don't concentrate, you would totally lose your place.
Oh, you have.
Yes.
Well, Tony will have to brush up his tack-making skills later, because one of Jane's horses is ready to take them for a ride in a handmade carriage.
Uka, and walk on. Good girl. Uka, come, walk on.
But it's time to get back in the saddle for their house hunt here in the beautiful Cornish countryside. We're heading to the village of St Clear. Situated on the southeastern flank of Bodmin Moor, this former mining village has an impressive Norman church at its heart. There are also two pubs serving food, a grocery store for provisions, along with a hairdresser. And located just under a mile west from the village centre, set back from a country lane, is the house we've come to see.
This is stunning. This is absolutely stunning.
It certainly is.
So it's what you imagine from your escape to the country, is it?
Yes.
It is.
Yes. First impressions are absolutely spot on. Yeah, really nice.
This seemed to really fit the bill for what you're looking for.
Oh, I think so, yes.
Yeah, it is stunning, yeah.
Am I tempting you?
Yes.
Do you want to come and have a look inside?
We do.
Yeah. Okay, sure. Come on then.
Thanks.
This impressive barn conversion was completed in the year 2000. With a sprawling ground floor layout, the entrance hall leads to a huge multifunctional kitchen and living space at the centre of the home, showcasing the building's agricultural heritage with contemporary finishes.
No way!
What is this?
Oh, my God.
This is to die for.
Oh, this is just amazing.
Look at these.
It's this massive open plan. Living, kitchen, dining, you know, chilling out space. And then there's a garden room through the double doors, which is currently used as a dining room.
Right.
There's quite a lot to talk about in here.
I'll bet. Are they basalt or...?
They're granite pillars and they go way down into the ground. Yeah. So they would have held the roof up.
Yeah.
And this was actually parking for the farm vehicles.
I've never seen anything like that in a house before.
It's fantastic. Absolutely fantastic.
Is it big enough for you? Because I'm very worried.
Oh, yeah, it's definitely big enough. It couldn't be more perfect.
OK, so you're keen to see any more
of
the house?
So we'd like to see the rest of it now.
No, we're keen to buy it.
Steady on. So if you let me squeeze through the middle of you,
lovely.
Follow me.
Tony's already reaching for his chequebook, but back across the entrance hall to the rear of the property is a further reception room with yet more farming heritage.
So come through into my parlour. And this actually used to be the old milking parlour.
Oh,
see,
really?
See what I did there?
Oh, yes, yes, very good.
And it's a really cosy space.
It
in
is.
Winter, this is probably where you'd want to hunker up.
The only thing I would be missing is my ingle nook, but whether there's something you could do with the fireplace.
Probably create one.
Yeah. But it is a lovely room still. Yeah, really nice.
Got a lovely beam, so much character.
Okay, good. Yeah. Well, you're still smiling.
Yeah, no, really nice.
Try
really
taking the smile off my face.
Shall we head upstairs and see if we can, you know, keep the smile going? Let's go and take a look at the bedrooms.
There's a lot to grin about on the ground floor, which also includes further accommodation off the entrance hall with a study, utility room, and downstairs shower room. At the other end of the house is the first of this home's five bedrooms, a double with an ensuite bathroom. The upper floor is arranged across two distinct sections, reached by separate staircases. One set of stairs leads to a huge double bedroom with a feature wood burner. Then, from the other staircase in the entrance hall, we find a cloakroom with wash basin and three further bedrooms, a single to the rear and an L-shaped room with a built-in bed. Lastly, bedroom number five is a generously proportioned master with both ensuite bathroom and dressing room.
Really gorgeous. And fabulous views over the countryside there.
And there is so much room, isn't there, in here?
And I've never had a dressing room before, so that's quite nice.
Well, I know the garden and the outside space is just as important to you as the house, so let's go and explore, and then I need you to start thinking about the price.
OK.
Have you got ideas yet?
No.
Not really.
It's great that Debbie and Tony are already thinking of ways to tweak this barn conversion's interior to make it work for them. Outside, there's a double stone garage and workshop space, plus a section of stream running through over an acre of grounds.
And it's not too manicured.
No, but very manageable, actually.
It is. Right, you've seen it all now. Yeah. So, Debbie, it's you to go first.
I'm going to say 515.
OK. She said hopefully under budget.
I would think it's pushing to the top end, 525.
I'm afraid you're both wrong. Right. You're both under. It's on the market for £550,000, okay. So it is over your budget. Yeah. Yeah. However, we've had a conversation with the owner, and they have said that they would seriously consider an offer from people who are in a strong position, which, of course, the two of you are.
Yes. Yeah.
That's good that they're willing to negotiate.
Go and think some more about this.
We'll go take another look,
and I'll catch up with you. This beautiful barn conversion may stretch the budget, but it offers an incredible amount of space inside and out, including an extensive open-plan kitchen and living space, 5 bedrooms and a total of 3 bathrooms. There's over an acre of grounds, all in an edge-of-village location.
I have to say I love this garden room.
So do I.
We'd live in here, wouldn't we?
Yeah.
Yeah, you'd have your breakfast in here, your dinner in here, yeah. You could just chill, you could have a dining table, you could have comfy wicker furniture.
Yeah.
Absolutely fantastic. Beautiful surroundings, great garden. I love the garden room. The kitchen is absolutely phenomenal and it couldn't be better downstairs. So lots of positive features.
I think the house is fabulous. There's so much character to this property as well, with all the exposed beams, granite pillars in the kitchen. And that's something you don't see every day.
Definitely could see myself living here.
I don't know about you two, but I found my favourite spot in the house. It's perfect.
You're looking very chilled.
Very at home here. Well, I think that's 2 really good viewings.
Yeah, really good. Can't thank you enough for finding 2 properties so far that have been excellent.
I think it's time to go and mull them over.
Okay? Absolutely.
We're in the county of Cornwall, helping soon-to-retire dentistry duo Tony and Debbie swap town centre living in Leamington for a house in the country. We've already shown them 2 great properties for their budget of £525,000. But for the mystery house, I'm about to whisk them away to somewhere very different.
You've been completely transported from a Cornish woodland to the Mediterranean.
And at the Royal Cornwall Show, I'm meeting some of the county's loveliest livestock.
These are the Valley Blacknose sheep, and they are deemed the world's cutest sheep.
They are such little sweethearts, they really are. We had a great day with Tony and Debbie yesterday, and I think our 2 properties certainly gave them plenty to consider. Now, I'm not sure that we've quite sealed the deal yet, but I do think that Tony in particular was quite taken with that barn conversion that had plenty of wow factor. And of course, there's still the mystery house to view. And this one is going to test just how game our couple are to really escape to the country.
So you two are off to see the mystery house.
We are.
Excited?
Very.
Yeah,
yes.
Very excited.
Oh, yes.
What are you expecting to see? Have you got any ideas?
Something unique, something a bit quirky, something different. It probably won't tick all the boxes.
A bit outside the box, as they say.
Oh, yeah, we'll definitely be outside the box.
Our mystery house is located in Cardenham Woods, a 3-mile drive from the town of Bodmin. Once the county capital in the 15th century, the town was the starting point for a 15,000-strong Cornish rebellion march on London, protesting increased taxes on tin mining. Although the uprising was quashed, Bodmin continued as an important mining centre into the 19th century. Then, in the 1950s, it provided a training facility for linguists working on Cold War intelligence. But just a short drive away, in the tranquility of Cardenham Woods, today's mystery location is a real one-off.
So I wanted to bring you here to such a beautiful woods. It's 650 acres and there's just miles and miles of walking trails and bike trails. You've got streams and little brooks running through it. And there's a fantastic woodland cafe as well. It'd be nice to have this on the doorstep, wouldn't it?
Oh, certainly. Totally. Yeah. Yeah. You could be in Canada, somewhere like that.
Yeah, it's really lovely.
Take the bikes out?
Yeah, well, I'm really pleased you've said that because our mystery house is right in the middle
of the woods.
Of the woods. Oh, Little Red Riding Hood country.
So get your Little Red Riding Hood capes on, because we're off to see the three bears.
Oh, brilliant.
Oh, wow.
Okay.
Fantastic.
Come on, Goldilocks.
Right this way, Goldilocks.
Well, I might have got my fairy tales mixed up, but down a single-track forestry road, there's no confusing the picture book credentials of our mystery house.
So, this is what I brought you to see.
Goodness, yeah. Look at the roses growing up the wall. Absolutely.
This
stunning.
Is almost a unique spot, isn't it? Oh, in the middle of Cardinham Woods.
Wow. It's really gorgeous.
One thing I do want to point out is just over there, you'll find your heated outdoor hot tub.
No way! No way!
So, are you keen to have a look?
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Okay, let's go and explore.
Let's hope this 1920s woodland home continues to deliver on the inside. Leading from the entrance hall, we pass through a dedicated separate dining area, which features a log-burning stove, and continue into a recent rear extension, where we find the L-shaped kitchen.
So you come through the sort of the dining space into the kitchen, which is at the back of the house.
Yeah. It's lovely. I love this room. The fact that it's open into the dining area is fantastic.
It is gorgeous. It is small.
Yeah. So the layout is you've got a good-sized family bathroom there, and then here is a storeroom and study. If it was me, I'd be really tempted to take all this out and completely open this up, which I think would give you the feeling of a much larger kitchen space.
No, that sounds like a good idea. And it would definitely open it out.
OK, good.
Yes.
So let's go through and explore the living space.
Right.
Let's head on.
Okay.
Retracing our steps to the other side of the entrance hall, we reach the final room on this floor.
It's the main living space.
That's a little compact.
It's a small, cosy house in the woods.
Yeah.
So it's a lovely, cosy room. You've got an open fireplace. I think you could put in planning permission to remove that wall completely and go out certainly as much again. And then you could put lovely bifolding doors or doors out onto the garden. I don't know if that would faze you, but there's definitely an option here if you've got planning to do that.
Yeah. I think you'd have to in a room this size. Mm. We wouldn't even get our couches in. Yeah, you'd have to do something, I think, to make it a bit bigger.
It's all doable.
So Tony is open to adapting this unique woodland home, but I'm sensing that Debbie has yet to be convinced. Upstairs, we find a second family bathroom and a total of four bedrooms. Two smaller bedrooms are above the rear extension, one of which is currently used as a nursery, and the second is being used as a workroom and office. There are also two good-sized guest rooms, both featuring built-in floor-to-ceiling storage, and each with enough space for double beds. But I'm really keen to show off the outside space. At around a third of an acre, it's been extensively landscaped by the current owners, who have also added an idyllically located summer house, the perfect spot for self-contained guest accommodation.
So up here at one of the highest points in the garden, you get a really good sense of the layout. So it's all been done in these terraces, and you've got raised vegetable beds and a greenhouse, and then you've got this kind of treetop decked area. You're up at the treetops.
It is very nice. They've made great use of space with the land they've got.
Mm.
Absolutely fantastic. But it's very tiered. It's,
yeah, a lot of up and down. I think another 10 years, we're probably going to regret having something like that.
So I've still got one trump card that I haven't played yet. And it could be the perfect antidote to all the walking there is up and down these terraces. Okay, you ready to have a look?
Yep, I'll have a look.
So you come down here, you've been completely transported from a Cornish woodland to the Mediterranean. With your hot tub, your outdoor shower, you've got an outdoor oven, sunbeds.
Yeah.
You're really not convinced, are you?
Again, I think it's done really nice. I can see little tea lights and cushions, but...
Just the wrong setting.
Yeah, I don't want Spanish hacienda in the forest, so it just, for me, doesn't work.
OK. So it's time for me to ask you to guess the price. Go on, Tony, over to you first.
OK, it's a very unique situation, without a doubt. I'm guessing 475.
Again, I agree with Tony. It's very, very pretty. I do think it's very rural. It's quite compact. I'm going to go slightly low and say 465.
I'm afraid, Tony, the drinks are on you because Debbie is absolutely bang on.
Shake my hand. Well
excellent. And I thought I was rubbish at this. So go and have another look around. Come and find me when you're ready.
Okay.
Right, off you
lovely.
Go. Thanks. At £60,000 below their top budget, this 1920s woodland home comes with a semi-open plan dining room and kitchen, two bathrooms and four bedrooms. There are extensively landscaped gardens, all in a unique forestry setting.
It is a beautiful little country cottage. For me, it's too unique. The garden's very tiered, and the space outside really doesn't fit the bill for me. I just wanted that outside space, so not for me, I'm afraid.
The setting is just phenomenal. I know it's not quite the right house for us. This is more a young person's house. A lot of running up and down, quite steep steps. Slightly flatter land and slightly bigger house, I'd be very tempted to live in the middle of the woods. It's just a lot of work and too much for us, I think.
Well, you can't deny it's a lovely, lovely spot.
Oh, absolutely.
Should we go off and search the three bears then?
Yeah, bring Goldilocks with me.
Yeah, I think we need to go and find somewhere and have a chat.
Okay.
If you're looking for a flavour of what the Cornish countryside has to offer, there's perhaps no better place to head than the annual Royal Cornish Show. Located in the Wadebridge Showground and featuring local food and drink, a flower show, tractor displays, and competitions for the best livestock and produce, over 100,000 people attend the three-day event, making it the biggest in the county. It's a truly rural spectacle dating back over three centuries. And to tell me more about it, Secretary of the Show, Chris Riddle.
So, Chris, the Royal Cornwall Show, it's got quite a history, hasn't it? You've been going for a few years.
Yes, we were originally founded in 1793. At the end of the 18th century, there was a real move away from living in the country. The farmer and the country had to produce more food. Food meant agriculture had to be improved, and agricultural societies such as our own were created to sort of feed that need. First year was purely a couple of ploughing matches. Livestock were added in the second year, and look to what we've got now.
What do you think its enduring popularity is?
I think it's because people's daily lives are perhaps ever more slightly removed from the reality of the rural world, and to come here and see it and have a real fun day out is what they love.
Among the highlights here are the livestock events, where farmers compete in a variety of categories for coveted prizes. This year, the sheep section has a record number of 1,292 entries. And I'm meeting Emma Collison, whose rare breed sheep have been awarded third places by this year's judges. But for me, they certainly get winning marks for adorability.
Well, Emma, in a tent that is absolutely packed with different breeds of sheep, I've definitely found the cutest. They're gorgeous. What are they?
These are the Valais black-nosed sheep, and they are deemed the world's cutest sheep.
They are such little sweethearts. They really are.
Emma was the first to import this breed from their native Switzerland, bringing 25 ewes and two rams to her Cornish farm 2 years ago.
And how have they been received over here?
Oh, they've taken the UK by storm, and also the internet, like all kinds of countries. I get emails from America on a daily basis asking for these sheep.
The thing for me that really stands out is their fleece. It's beautiful, isn't it? Is that something the judges would have been looking for?
Yeah, so the judges are looking for black knees at the front, black nose, black all the way around the eye with no break, black ears all the way to the top, and on the females, a black bottom, as you can see. There's a little black bum there.
Is it your hope that their popularity will grow?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, we've been from just me to 50 breeders in 2 years, which is a massive amount of people taking them on. They're just an amazing breed, and everyone loves them, and they make good pet sheep. It's a good breed for everybody.
As well as the county's cutest sheep, the variety of tasty fare on offer in the food pavilion is sure to tempt. Gourmet delights from cider to sausages assail the senses. And it's here I'm meeting Cornish cheesemaker Catherine Mead, who makes a local variety I'm particularly fond of.
Yarg is one of my favourite cheeses.
Thank you.
But I don't know much about it. So what kind of cheese is it?
It's a naturally matured, naturally mould-ripened cheese. We mature it over 5 to 6 weeks, and so we would call it quite young. So it's young, fresh, quite lactic, semi-hard cheese.
Around 2 tonnes of nettles and wild garlic leaves are hand-picked each year, and used separately to wrap and create two distinct products, both unique to Catherine's award-winning Cornish dairy. Something which has left me with a question.
I always eat the nettles. Is that what you're supposed to do?
Absolutely, yeah. Oh, gosh, we spend that much time and that much effort putting nettles on cheese. We want people to eat them. The nettle leaf is permeable, so you've got this natural movement of oxygen and also of moisture.
I mean, my mouth's watering, actually. Can I try
Let's
and
have
see
a
if...
taste.
What I love. You're almost getting, like, three cheeses in one with it.
And that's the way it's sort of the way it's maturing, so that it is creamy under that rind and slightly crumbly in the core. And here is the wild garlic yarn. So in this one, this is interesting because the leaf is not sticking to the cheese.
That's it. That's absolutely beautiful. I can't believe that they're the same cheese.
That's really hard to imagine.
Well, after such an appetising introduction to country life in Cornwall, it's time to find out if we've come up with something for Tony and Debbie to get their teeth into in our Cornish house hunt.
Well, I'm pretty sure I know what Tony and Debbie are thinking at this point, but let me have a talk to them and find out. Well, if you had any doubts about why you're moving to Cornwall, that view's going to put them to rest, isn't it?
It certainly is.
So let's talk about the last couple of days and our house hunt. What are your thoughts now? What are you feeling about the properties that we've seen? Is there a what next with any of them?
I don't think any of the three actually match totally what we need or what we want. Mm.
But interesting that there are certain things that you liked about various ones.
Yeah, I think house number one had perfect land. I loved the meadow. Really, really pretty. Location was fantastic, right next to Lostwithiel, which is a beautiful, beautiful place.
The one you're actually most drawn to in terms of location is not on the edge of a village, as you were convinced you wanted. It's actually on the edge of a fairly small town.
Yes. Yeah, I think that did change our minds completely.
Yes. To be involved in a small village community was possibly slightly idealistic from our point of view. I think we would still rather be near more facilities, more amenities. Moving our search area around Lostwithiel, I think, would be fantastic.
Yeah, completely worth coming, worth the visit.
Well, I'm sorry we didn't manage to find your dream home, but look, it's all out there, it's waiting for you.
Yeah, thank
sure
you so
that.
Much. Yeah, it's been
Thanks a
absolutely
lot.
Fantastic.
Well, it's the end of our search here in Cornwall, and I think it's wonderful that we've introduced Tony and Debbie to a part of the county that they've fallen in love with. We wish them all the best with their search and their new life together here. Join me next time on Escape to the Country.
If you'd like to escape to the country in England, Northern Ireland, Wales or Scotland and need our help, you can apply online at bbc.co.uk/beonashow.